of state law. These expenses did not comply with IRS requirements, and as a result, all such expenses should have been included by the NRA in taxable personal income for Mr. LaPierre and other recipients. 18 million dollars. A significant amount of these funds included payments through this side agreement. And their financial of the NRA, Mr. illegal behavior. The complaint lays out numerous other instances in which Mr. LaPierre, Mr. Phillips, Mr. Powell, and Mr. Frazier, and other executives and board members at the NRA abused their power and illegally diverted or facilitated the diversion of tens of millions of dollars from the NRA. These funds were in addition to millions of dollars the four individual defendants were already receiving in grossly excessive salaries and bonuses that were baseless and did not adhere to prudent standards for evaluating and determining compensation as is required by law. Altogether, there are 18 causes of action, and these actions violated multiple laws and raised charitable status and annual filings with my office and the IRS, improper expense documentation, improper wage reporting, improper income tax withholding, failure to make required excise tax reporting and payments in excess of reasonable compensation to disqualified persons, and waste of NRA assets, amongst other offenses. For these years of fraud and misconduct, we are seeking an order to dissolve the NRA in its entirety, to require Mr. LaPierre, Mr. Phillips, Mr. Powell, and Mr. Frazier to make full restitution for funds they unlawfully profited and salaries they earned while employees, and pay penalties. To remove Mr. LaPierre and Mr. Frazier from the NRA's leadership, and to ensure none of the four individual defendants can ever again serve on the board of a charity in New York State. It's important to note that Mr. Phillips and Mr. Powell have left the NRA. It's clear that the NRA has been failing to carry out its stated mission for many, many years, and instead has operated as a breeding ground for greed, abuse, and brazen illegality. In this state, we have a set of laws that every individual and entity must be held accountable to, regardless of who you are, regardless of your power, size, influence, wealth, or station in life. One set of laws. And today, we send a strong and loud message that no one is above the law, not even the NRA. One of the most powerful organizations in this country. Again, I'd like to thank the Chief of the Charities Bureau, Jim Sheehan, and the Co-Chief of the Enforcement Section, Emily Stern. And they led with a dedicated and experienced and professional team of attorneys who I am very proud to be associated with. Also a team of accountants, legal assistance, and they include Assistant Attorney General and Special Counsel of the Litigation Bureau, Monica Connell, Assistant Attorney General William Wang, Assistant Attorney General Sharon Sash, Assistant Attorney General Jonathan Conley, Assistant Attorney General Stephen Thompson, and Assistant Attorney General Erica James, all of the Charities Bureau, with additional assistance from Chief Accountant Judith Welsh Libros, Assistant Associate Accountant Darren Buchamp, and Associate Accountant Charles Aganu, in addition to numerous other individuals at the Office of Attorney General. The Charities Bureau is part of the Division for Social Justice, which is supervised by Chief Deputy Attorney General Megan Fox and First Deputy Attorney General Jennifer Levy, who were integral and instrumental in overseeing this entire process. And now, my friends, I'm happy to take questions. Yes, sir.
Shimon Prokop has from CNN. I can see this already developing from the president and certainly the Republicans who are going to say that you're only going after the NRA because of their support of him and because of their support of the Republicans. How would you respond to that?
By no means. This was an investigation that started in 2019 until this day. It's based on the facts. We follow the facts and the law, and we come to conclusions of law. And as a result of that, we've come to the conclusion that the NRA, unfortunately, was serving as a personal piggy bank to four individual defendants.
And if I could just follow up. Powerful organization. This could not have been an easy decision in some ways to come to. Why call for it to dissolve instead of just the removal of these people and try to keep this organization intact? Why is it that this organization now needs to basically go away?
Because the corruption was so broad, and because of the level of waste, and because they have basically destroyed all of the assets of the corporation, it was critically important that one of the causes of actions and one of the remedies that we are seeking is the dissolution of the NRA.
Larry Neumeister at the Associated Press. Okay. Courts always look for prior precedents to do something like this. What's the prior precedents that you would cite for dissolving an organization over fraud?
So there are two prior cases in the last couple of years. One is called the Multicultural Federation of Multicultural Programs out of Brooklyn, and the second is the Trump Foundation.
Why, in terms of criminal charges here, why are there no criminal charges, and why have you chosen to go to civil path?
The Office of Attorney General, particularly in regards to the not-for-profit law, is tasked with having jurisdiction over not-for-profits in the civil realm and not the criminal realm. And that's why this is a civil enforcement action.
If the NRA was to, Megan Palin from the U.S. Sun, if the NRA was to be dissolved, what sort of effect or what would that mean for the wider issue of gun violence in this country? I know you've been supportive and outspoken of gun control before.
So this has nothing to do with my personal opinion with regards to gun violence. This has to do with the fact that four individual defendants and the NRA as a corporation, unfortunately, did not follow not-for-profit law in the state of New York. And as a result of that, they should be held accountable. And that's why we seek their dissolution. We seek the banning of these four individual defendants. We seek restitution. It's primarily because these individuals, unfortunately, did not follow the mission of the NRA.
Down?
Is this the moment that you've been waiting for? It's not a question of a moment that I've been waiting for. This is a question, again, of following the facts and applying the law. And when you apply the law and you come to a conclusion, the only conclusion that you can come to is that these four individual defendants, as well as the NRA and all of its directors and officers, violated the law. And they did it over a period of a year. And it went on unchecked for a period of a year. And we came to the conclusion, based upon our thorough investigation, that enough was enough, and we needed to step in and dissolve this corporation just as we did with the Trump Foundation.
Just finally, we'll take one more question in the room, and then we're going to go to the virtual.
Do you have any concerns for your own safety, considering the NRA is such a powerful organization and does have so much support now that you're sort of leading this? Do you have any concerns?
None whatsoever.
Okay, we're going to go to virtual calls. My colleague Kelly will introduce the callers on the phone.
Good afternoon. For the reporters who have joined us virtually for today's press conference, please use the raise hand function at the bottom of your screen if you wish to ask a question. Our first question today will come from Danny Hakim from the New York Times.
Yeah, hi. Hello, Attorney General.
Hi, Danny.
Do you anticipate seeking or making a criminal referral in this matter, and would you rule out doing so in the future if you're not planning to do so now?
This is an ongoing first of all, thank you for the question. It's an ongoing investigation, and if we uncover any criminal activity, we will refer it to the Manhattan District Attorney. But at this point in time, we're moving forward again in civil enforcement.
Our next question will come from Tara Lenning of the Washington Post.
Attorney General James, this is Carol Lenning. Thanks for your news conference. I have a question about your findings regarding LaPierre's ability to avoid reporting expenses as personal income on his personal income taxes. Have you or will you refer that to the IRS? And do you believe he evaded personal income taxes in a pattern over several years?
So I will not, again, come to a conclusion on whether or not he violated the Internal Revenue Code. We are in the midst of submitting our complaint to the IRS, and we will contact the IRS accordingly.
Thank you. Our next question will come from Stephen Gandel from CBS.
Hi, thanks very much for taking my question. So many people today were speculating that the conference was going to be related to President Donald Trump. Can you give us an update on any investigations you have of President Trump or the Trump Organization? The Manhattan DA has reportedly received documents from Deutsche Bank. You have also subpoenaed Deutsche Bank. Have they complied with your subpoena? And if so, can you give us a sense of what they've given you?
Thank you for that question, which is not the subject of today's press conference and will not comment on any other investigation. Thank you.
Our next question will come from John Campbell from Gannett News.
Hi, Attorney General. The Trump Foundation lawsuit, which predated you here, it resulted in a settlement. Are you open to any sort of settlement talks with the NRA that would result in anything less than dissolution of the organization?
Thank you for the question, and it is not my habit to negotiate any resolution in public. We have filed our complaint today. There are 18 causes of action. They include but are not limited to the dissolution of the NRA in its entirety.
Our next question will come from Mark Marimont from the Wall Street Journal.
Sorry, I was muted. Attorney General, thank you so much for the time.
Sure.
I was wondering if the, since you're seeking to dissolve this organization, is it possible that that this could lead to some kind of a tit for tat? In other words, conservative attorney generals in other states might take some kind of an action like this. Or is it possible that the NRA could say, okay, if you want to dissolve us, then we'll just move to Wyoming or Oklahoma, and now we're done with New York. In other words, you no longer would have power over this organization.
I'm not going to speculate as to the future plans of the NRA. The NRA again was formed under the not-for-profit laws in the state of New York, and as a result, the Office of Attorney General has supervisory jurisdiction over all not-for-profits, including but not limited to the NRA.
Our next question will come from Eric Larson of Bloomberg.
Yes, hello.
Hi.
The allegations that you've laid out here suggest that the NRA donors and members here were really essentially victimized, allegedly, by these actions. And is it not further victimizing them by forcing their organization to close an organization that's pretty popular across the whole country? Is that necessarily fair to these victims here?
The issue is the following. A number of donors have contributed to the NRA because they believe in their mission. At this point in time, the NRA right now is financially in a deficit. And as a result of four individual defendants who have basically looted its assets. And so one would think that the donors would like for an organization to have some governance, some standards of behavior, and that they would recognize their fiduciary duty to a not-for-profit and or its mission, as opposed to looting assets and using it for their own personal benefit and or and their family.
For our next question will be Jesus Garcia from El Diario.
Hi, thank you, General Attorney. Do you find that part of that money was used in political campaigns? If yes, which one?
So that is not a subject of this press conference today, but I do want you to know that our investigation is ongoing.
Thank you. Our next person will be Henry Rosoff from PIX 11.
Well, Attorney General, thank you for taking my question. I was just wondering if you could walk us through the next couple of immediate steps with the understanding that this type of legal action can take years. What will we see in the coming weeks and months?
So I'm confident that there will be a response that will be filed by the NRA. We will go through a series of motions. There will be discovery. It's a normal course of action in all of our cases. And so we will continue to keep you abreast of the status of this litigation.
Our next question will be from Victoria Petempas from the New York City Courts Media.
Hi, Attorney General James. Thanks for taking my question. Many have criticized the settlement your office brokered with the Weinstein Company, maintaining that the sum would have been greater if Weinstein personally had to pay into it. At any point during the settlement process, did you consider or advocate for Harvey Weinstein paying into the settlement? And if not, why not?
So that's not the subject of the press conference here today. We will be giving you an update in regards to the Weinstein negotiations. And I thank you for the question.
We have time for two more questions. Our next question will be from Paul DiRienzo from WBAL.
Okay, just let me. Thank you very much for your taking this call, Attorney General. My question is, will you attempt to freeze the assets of the targets of this investigation or of the NRA, or in any way try and prevent them from doing business during this investigation?
That is one of the remedies that we are seeking in our pleadings. And so we look forward to, again, doing investigation to determine if there are any hidden assets and whether or not they can be frozen, for the purposes of benefiting those donors who have given to the NRA over the years for its intended mission.
Thank you. And our last question today will be from Sonia Moog from the CNN.
Hi, Attorney General. Thanks so much for taking my question. It's actually a two-parter. One, it seems like there's a lot of allegations of potential tax fraud here. Has this been reported to the IRS? And two, why take the measure to dissolve the entire organization instead of just removing these members? Can you speak to why that was necessary in this case?
We thank you for those questions that were previously asked and answered, but we will answer them again. We will be forwarding the complaint to the IRS, and we'll be in touch with the IRS in regards to any violations of the Internal Revenue Code. Because of the numerous complaints and based upon the facts and the application of law, we concluded that the best way to address this matter was to seek resolution before a New York State Supreme Court judge. And that is what we are seeking. Again, given the breadth and the depth of the corruption, the illegality, and the brazen attempts to basically evade the law. I thank you all for coming.